I know it's a lot of hard work that you did, so we're so happy to have you here.
Thank you.
And I'd also like to say a special welcome to anyone who is watching on Facebook Live or is listening on their phone. We're so delighted that you are here, and we're just happy that we can connect with you in all kinds of different ways. We're very pleased to be in person for most people, but if you're not able to come and be here in person, then we also want you to feel like you are a part of this worship service. So welcome. And Lynn, would you like to share the announcements?
There will be pie making on the 25th of February, that's next Friday, and also on the 4th of March. There is a stewards meeting in the hall, February 23rd at 7:30. Stewards meeting in the hall at 7:30. UCW, March 10th at 1 p.m. And on the 6th of March, the trustees will meet following the church service in the hall. And the annual meeting is March 13th, and if you have to have a report in, it should be in by the end of the month. So I think that's all the announcements I have. Is there anything else?
One more. I did get a note from Trinity St. Andrew's United Church in Renfrew, and they are inviting us to their Lenten study, which will be held on Mondays at 1 p.m. They're looking at a book called Freeing Jesus by Diana Butler Bass. And if you want any more details about that, I know Renfrew is a bit of a ways, but they have invited a number of churches to come in and be a part of this. So we are one of those churches that have been invited. Let's sing together our gathering music. Will you come and see the light?
In this season of the beginning, inspire us to look around
$1.99. And just when we have Philip with us, and he can play pretty much anything, I've chosen a few, maybe not as common hymns as that we normally sing, but just to give us something different. So it's God whose love is reigning o'er us.
Shall be near me, you and your children's children, as well as your flocks, your herds, and all that you have. I will provide for you there, since there are 5 more years of famine to come, so that you and your household and all that you have will not come to poverty. And he kissed all his brothers and wept upon them. And after that, his brothers talked with him. The scripture reading, or our second scripture reading, is taken from the New Testament, Luke 6, starting at verse 27. But I say to you that listen, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who abuse you. If anyone strikes you on the cheek, offer the other also. And from anyone who takes away your coat, do not withhold even your shirt. Give to everyone who begs from you, and if anyone takes away your goods, do not ask for them again. Do to others as you would have them do to you. If you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? For even sinners love those who love them. If you do good to those who do good to you, what credit is that to you? For even sinners do the same. If you lend to those from whom you hope to receive, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners to receive as much again. But love your enemies, do good, and lend expecting nothing in return. Your reward will be great, and you will be children of the Most High, for he is kind to the ungrateful and the wicked. Be merciful, just as your Father is merciful. Do not judge, and you will not be judged. Do not condemn, and you will not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. Give, and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, will be put into your lap, for the measure that you give will be the measure you get back. May God add his blessing to this, his holy word.
Joseph and his brothers would have been well known to Jesus. He would have known about this amazing story, about this great forgiveness that happens when Joseph confronts his brothers. And if you look at the Old Testament carefully, sibling rivalry, especially brothers against brothers, is common in the Old Testament. We just think of the story of Cain and Abel. Cain murdered his own brother. And Jacob and Esau. Jacob stole the birthright from Esau. These stories are the foundation of the creation of a moral universe that tries to deal with our killing instincts. As children, flashes of this occur. Now, I was the sixth child in a family of 9 children, 6 girls and 3 boys. And I was the one girl that was born between brothers. And down the road, my uncle's family consisted of 2 boys and 2 girls. And in many ways, our families felt like one family. that my cousins were also my brothers and sisters. So one day, as boys will do, my brother Rob and my cousin Danny were teasing me. And I don't actually remember anything about what it was actually about. But I do remember that I found a baseball bat and started chasing them around the yard. And I was so angry. I know that I would have hurt them if I had made contact. But thank goodness that they could run faster than I could. Joseph wasn't so lucky. Remember the story? He's the favorite son of Jacob because he's the first son of Rachel. In all that family, there are 11 other brothers born by Leah, which is Rachel's sister, and other female slaves. Now, Jacob makes a special coat for Joseph because he loves him more than the others, and it's right there in the text. It says it clearly. And so the brothers hate him. They decide to kill him by throwing him into a pit, but change their minds at the last minute, and they sell him into slavery for 30 pieces of silver. And the slave traders are the ones who take him to Egypt. So you can see how this foundational story is so important to the history of Israel. It sets up the confrontation between Egypt and the Hebrews. It sets up the colonization of Egypt by the Hebrew people. The brothers are forgiven their terrible deed, and the family settles near Joseph. Why would Joseph be so merciful and gracious to these mean men? Perhaps he realizes this. Retribution would never solve the violence done to him. It would only perpetuate. The healing of the family depends on forgiveness. The survival of the family depends on forgiveness. The famine of the land is not over. And by bringing his brothers and their families to Egypt, they prosper. This is the kind of forgiveness Jesus is talking about. Forgiveness, which is really, really hard. Whenever I think about forgiving our enemies and how difficult that is, I think of a man by the name of Bud Welch. His only daughter, Julie, was killed in the Oklahoma bombing. And if we can remember that, that was in about 1995. And over 100 people were killed in that bombing. For a year, the only thing he wanted was retribution. And Bud went to the bomb site every day for a year after her death. Not too long after that, as he watched the people leaving items at the site, he realized that he was stuck, that he wasn't moving forward. And he had been numbing his pain with alcohol, and it wasn't working. Now, Bud knew that his daughter, Julie, was opposed to the death penalty. And in honor of her, he decided to campaign against it. And a few years later, he was invited to meet the killer's family. Now, can you imagine that? What courage that would take. But what he discovered was that Bill McVeigh and his daughter Jennifer were the biggest victims of the Oklahoma bombing. And he said to them, "I don't want your brother to die, and I will do everything I can to prevent it." But of course, we all know in hindsight that he didn't prevent that death. But his work led to the abolishment of the death penalty in 6 states. See, as crazy as that sounds to our ears, as hard as it is for us to imagine ourselves in that position, Bud Welch, like Joseph, like Jesus, knows that retribution will never solve the violence done to him. It will only perpetuate it. And this is the very truth that Jesus preaches in this sermon on the level plain. Love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who abuse you. This sermon underlines everything we hold dear about the Jesus way. Do to others as you would have them do to you. Even Jesus recognizes that loving the ones who love you is easy. Jesus is asking us to take the harder road, the road Bud Welch had to walk down. And why? Why would we do that? Why should we not run around with a baseball bat and try to hurt those people who hurt us? It felt good to me in that moment. All that anger and rage bubbling up to the surface. But we have all of history to teach us that the pain we inflict on others only makes the situation worse, not better. When I was chasing my brothers with that baseball bat, my father intervened. And yes, he wasn't too pleased with me, but I wasn't the one who really got the brunt of his discipline. He knew those boys could be mean to their sister. And I'll never forget that they were the ones who got into more trouble than I did. Jesus is always trying to get us to do the hard stuff, like being merciful when we don't feel merciful, like giving the shirt off our back when someone has taken our coat, like lending money and not expecting it in return. Jesus even tells us, and it is right in that scripture reading, have a look if you want to see it and make sure that I've got this right. It says it right in that Lucan reading, God is kind to the ungrateful and the wicked. Wow. That seems to be a pretty impossible standard for us to live up to. That's why we come to church every Sunday. Because Jesus asks us to do really difficult things, and we need the strength to understand why. We need the power of God to do the impossible. We need to discuss the ethical issues that come before us with our neighbors. Religious communities ask the big questions about what love really means. Even Jesus challenges us. He says, if you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? If you do good to those who do good to you, what credit is that to you? If you lend to those from whom you hope to receive, what credit is that to you? It's hard for us to hear this in, you know, when we live in such a transactional world. And what I mean by that is that if I do a good turn, I expect a good turn to come my way. If we are citizens and residents of the kingdom of God, then Jesus is asking us to be more like God. And that means to be merciful, just as God is merciful. Joseph knew that retribution wouldn't bring his family back. He missed his father, he missed his younger brother Benjamin, he missed his older brothers. He sought out their love and chose love over hate. And Jesus is trying in his own way to teach us this lesson. Bud Welch knew that Timothy McVeigh's death would not bring back his daughter. His faith led him down a path that helped his fellow citizens to have compassion, even in the midst of destruction and death. Now, we're generally peaceful people. We don't really know what it means to live like through a huge tragedy, and perhaps you do, and I just don't know about it. But I have known the reality of bullying, just as you probably have. And my faith has taught me this. No one should be bullied, including the bullies. Two wrongs don't make a right. Love is a healing force that changes ill will to goodwill. Doing good to others creates a circle of positivity. Blessing those who curse you deflects that pain from bringing you down. And praying for those who abuse you means you are wishing them well and longing for them to change for your sake and for the sake of the world. Jesus is trying to teach us how to make a difference in an often dark world. Love, do good, bless, pray. It's the Christian way. And it's a good way to bring peace to our communities. Amen.
Thank you.
thank you to Philip and to Carol for reading the scripture, and Travis for taking care of the sound, and thank you for being here. Thank you to those who are listening or watching on Facebook Live. Thank you for being a community. In light of everything we've been seeing in our own city, I believe that it is communities like this where you form the values that are important in the way that we live out our lives and the way that we treat each other. Yes, we can disagree, but we can't hurt each other. And Christian communities are so important for that opportunity to discuss and to read our ancient scripture and to feel like we are in this together, and to teach us how to love our neighbor as ourselves, because sometimes we don't love our neighbor. We don't even like our neighbor. We don't want to be beside our neighbor. But Jesus teaches us how to love our neighbor. And so these are some of the thoughts I've been having as we see what's been happening in Ottawa. So all that to say that I just want to thank you for your contributions to this church, because I think sometimes we take it for granted how important it is to have these kind of communities in our towns and in our areas like West Carleton. So let's come before God and thank God for these gifts. Let us pray. Gracious God, you have given so much to us, friendships and family, neighbors, the beauty of the earth, good food. Help us each day to be grateful for them. And we bless all the gifts that are given to this church, and we ask your guidance as we use them in your service. In Jesus' name, amen. And as we turn to our pastoral prayer, I just want to mention that I was asked to pray for a very special little boy. His name is Jaden. He's 3 years old, and he is James' grandson.
It's Caden.
Oh, I'm sorry, Caden. I'm sorry about that wrong. Caden, that's a nice name. Jane's grandson, and he is looking towards having an operation on Wednesday at Chito, and we want to include him in our prayers today. So if we can also include Caden in our prayers during the week, that would be very helpful for the family and for Jane. Are there any other prayer requests?
We pray for our friend Lucy. She had cataract surgery on Friday, but with some difficulties. So she would appreciate some prayers to help her with her recovery.
Okay.
My mother, Elsa.
Elsa, that's right. Yes, I have her included after him. How is she? Still the same?
Still the same.
And I'm sorry, the name again, Nancy? Lucy.
Lucy.
Great, okay. Let us come before God in prayer. Let us pray. Merciful God, we thank you for the story of Joseph and his brothers, and how forgiveness changed their relationship forever. We thank you for the words of Jesus, words that challenge us to do the hard work of loving, doing good, blessing others, and praying for all. We thank you for forgiving us when we hurt others. And we pray for the strength to forgive others when we've been hurt. This weekend, and we especially pray for our city of Ottawa. May its residents know peace and good order. May the neighborhood of Centretown be restored to its normal daily activities. We pray for the House of Commons and the Senate as they debate the Emergencies Act. We pray for law enforcement officers and all their support staff, for businesses, tow truck drivers, and journalists. We pray for the protesters as they return to their homes. May our ears be open to all sides of the protest and be willing to seek reconciliation and build trust. We pray for the country of Ukraine and hope for a swift resolution. Oh God, we pray for our own community. We continue to pray for Walter, Wynn, Nelda, Elsa, and Debbie. We pray for Lucy. We pray for Caden and Caden's family. We pray for Jim Boss and his family as they grieve the death of a dear wife and mother. We pray for those who are in hospital or long-term care facilities. In this season of Epiphany, may we continue to look for the light that guides our way and gives us hope. Help us to live out the words of Jesus, who teaches us so much about the nature of God and how to live in this messy and beautiful world. We pray all this as we say together the prayer that Jesus taught to us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Thank you. others creates a circle of positivity. Blessing those who curse you deflects the pain from bringing you down. Praying for those who abuse you means you are wishing them well and longing for them to change. Go boldly into the world, surrounded by God's unwavering love. Amen.
Thank you.